7:32, and this is the big talker this morning. The plan to delay the start of school year for more than 1.1 million New York City school kids. That came together overnight. Chancellor Richard Carranza, one of the people behind that decision, and he joins us live this morning to continue this conversation. Good morning to you, Chancellor. Thank you for coming on this morning.
Good morning, Dan. Thanks for having me.
So this was big news yesterday. A lot of teachers, a lot of parents were wondering what was going to happen here. So was the threat of a teacher strike the deciding factor in pushing back the start date here?
No, as we've said all along, it's making sure that we have a safe, orderly start to the school year. And as we were getting closer to that September 10th deadline, it became apparent that we just needed more time. We were hearing that from principals, from teachers. This will give us the time that we need to make sure that the safety and health protocols are in place.
Right.
But it will also allow us to make sure that the remote learning plans are in place, that teachers have time to check in with students. So it was really, really functional to make sure that we have a safe and healthy start to the school year.
So there was some confusion over the two start dates of the 16th and the 21st. Can you clear up that confusion for us this morning?
Sure. So September 21st is the first day of blended learning, remote learning. The whole program starts on September 21st. However, what's important is that teachers will still report to their buildings on September 8th. That's critical because teachers need time to implement all of these safety protocols, to practice how are we going to monitor the one-way hallways, how are we going to make sure social distancing is in the classroom, set up your classrooms. So all of that will happen starting September 8th. Between September 16th and 18th, parents should expect teachers to be making contact with their students, making sure that they have their devices, making sure that they can log on, making sure they know where to find the curriculum, setting up the communication protocols, et cetera. That'll happen between the 16th and the 18th. And then on the 21st, it's full-blown. If you've chosen blended learning, you come in. If you're in remote learning, we've started the school year.
So the UFT, we had them on here a few times. Michael Mogru described this long list of demands that you know about in order for teachers to head back to school. Among them was the 30-day supply of PPE, proper ventilation. Every single person must get tested prior to entering a school building. Where do you stand on meeting some of that safety plan?
Check, 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 check. That's what was so powerful about all of us coming together and really having this conversation. Look, we've been working very closely, not only with UFT, but SEIU, CSA, all of our unions, because we all have a vested interest in making sure that students and staff are safe in an in-person learning environment. I'm going to just remind us again, because of the hard work that New Yorkers have done, you put us in a position where we can even consider in-person learning. So all of the things that UFT has been talking about, we've actually reached agreement with them, and we have protocols, we have guidelines, we have processes in place to ensure all of those things are going to be done.
So by the 21st, every school's ventilation system will have been checked and approved and up and running?
By today, every single school will have been evaluated, and we have a running list of classrooms that need to have some work done to them. And our commitment has always been that if a classroom is not properly ventilated, we just won't use that classroom until we can make it so that it's a safe environment for students and staff to be in. So all of that, all the evaluations will be done by today. There's already lots of work crews that are working on following up on any things that have been found in terms of ventilation in our classrooms and buildings.
And so the nurses in each specific school, do you have enough of them come September 21st?
Absolutely. We needed about 400. We are halfway there already. The other half, obviously anybody that comes into a school building, there's a very, very rigorous vetting process that has to happen. Background checks. So the other half of them are going through background checks right now. Again, remember, we had a start date of September 10th as our goal. So we will have all of the nurses for every single building ready to go by September 10th, even though they're going to start on the 21st.
Understood. So what would you say then right now is the biggest challenge that you are facing to get in place by the 21st or the 10th, if you want to set that as your date?
Well, we've talked about busing continues to be one of those issues that is very difficult. But We are we're going to have more to say about this in the next day or so, but we are right now in the final stages of contracts, signing contracts with our bus providers. We're prioritizing students with disabilities for busing. I think the other thing that's really taking up a lot of our time is making sure that we have a robust remote learning environment. Mm-hmm. Because every student will have some semblance of a remote learning experience.
Right.
So making sure people have devices, they have connectivity, they have a curriculum, and then really being really tight about our professional development for our teachers when they return on the 8th. Not only is it academics, but we're also going to be really pushing a trauma-informed approach because all of us have undergone trauma during this pandemic. Yeah. How do we reorient children and have them process what they've gone through?
How many students will be in each individual classroom? And then a follow-up to that is, if you are doing remote learning, who is your teacher, right? Is it the same teacher that's teaching the in-person learning?
So the number of students is going to be dependent upon how much space there is in a classroom. Obviously, the larger the classroom, the more students you can have in that classroom, still adhering to all of the medical guidelines. But generally speaking, it'll be between 9 and 12 students in a classroom, and then a teacher. Obviously, if there's more than one teacher, then you reduce the number of students in that classroom. So very rigorous protocols. The other thing that's really important is that because we recognize that there's about 15% of our teachers that have applied for and are receiving medical accommodations,
right.
Those teachers become remote learning teachers.
Okay.
And that varies depending on the school campus. So and we're really rock solid on this, is that every student that's in remote learning will have a teacher that's teaching them remotely that is from their campus, because we want to make sure students are connected to their campus. But look, people ask me, can you guarantee it? I can't guarantee that, because it's going to depend. If you have a school that doesn't have enough teachers in remote or has too many teachers in remote, then we may need to augment with other teachers, other pedagogues,
right.
that have teaching credentials from across the system. So that is our goal. That's what we're working towards. That is our first priority. But again, I can't guarantee that, because it's all based on how many people we have based on the school.
Appreciate
and based on
the honesty there. I'm running out of time. I have two more questions. One is the fact that monthly COVID testing will now be required for anyone entering a school building. What happens if a person refuses?
Look, we're going to talk to people. Same thing with masks, wearing masks. We're in a global pandemic that has cost the lives of hundreds of thousands of people in the United States. So there are certain things we're going to have to do, and testing is one of those things. So we're going to talk to people. We're going to encourage them. We're going to ask them to please do that. But if a student refuses to be part of the testing, then I think they've elected remote learning until we have a vaccine.
And lastly, you talked about this yesterday at one of your press conferences, and it has to do with what's going to happen in November, which is, of course, voting and polling places. And so many, over 700 schools are used as polling places. Can you commit that schools will in fact be a polling place? And if they are, how do you keep the students safe when you're monitoring who's coming in and out?
So what we're going to do is, and thanks for letting me clarify this. So what we're going to do is, for early voting, we're working with the Board of Elections to have alternate locations for early voting, because obviously once we sanitize and clean a school, we want them to stay sanitized and clean. But on election day, school sites that are selected as election polling sites will still be used as polling sites. On that day, students will be in remote learning mode. So students and staff will not be in the school building. They'll be used as election sites. And then obviously at the end of that voting time, we're going to deep clean them, we're going to sanitize them, and have them ready for the next day for school.
Understood. And those were my two questions. But I did speak to Angela Torres from District H. She's a parent in the Bronx. I promised her I would ask you a question on her behalf. And she had wanted to know about federal funding. She said that if you didn't receive those funds, you had thrown out the idea of possible teacher layoffs, 9,000 layoffs. Where do you stand on that?
Well, the mayor talked about this yesterday as well. And, you know, one of the, I think, really powerful things about us working very closely with our labor partners is that our labor partners have also now weighed in. So we're seeking a borrowing authority, long-term borrowing authority from Albany. And if that happens, then we're going to be able to avert any layoffs. And the mayor has already put a pause to sending out those layoff notices because we have a commitment from our labor partners who are working with us to get that long-term borrowing authority. So we are very hopeful. And when that happens, then we will be able to continue to move forward towards our opening date on September 21st.
Understood. Chancellor Richard Carranza, thank you for coming on such an important morning. Appreciate your time.
Thanks, Dan. Great tie, by the way.
I was going to say, we got the green memo. There we go. All right. Enjoy. Thank you.